One, two, three.
Hello, welcome to Rock the Cash Bar. I'm Ben Mowbray.
And I'm Diane Gallagher.
Every week we pick one song and do a deep dive into the lyrics and explain the different ways they've been interpreted.
We will also discuss how the song connected to us on a personal level, focusing on all the embarrassing details.
Glad to have you here. Enjoy the show.
Good afternoon. Good magical evening. Joyous Noel, Diane. How are you?
Good. Merry Christmas, Ben.
Oh, the big flip of your Santa hat, your tiny little Santa hat. Where did you get that?
My son. His whole class got it on Polar Express Day, the last day he was in school. I stole it. Like the Grinch.
Is it Polar Express Day? Are we not allowed to call it Christmas Day?
Well, they watched the movie. They all got like the little bell. So it was a whole theme.
Oh, that's adorable. Making the Christmas magic.
Yes.
I've got a stocking stuffing tradition in, I don't have any kids, so I don't have to like arrange the magic of Christmas myself. But the little magic that we do is we stuff each other's stockings for the family that's going to be going around on Christmas Eve. So you never really know who that's going to be or what the plan's going to be. So I just went to Target and I just bought enough stuff to stuff everybody's stocking. And nice. They're just sitting in Target bags. And then my girlfriend came home and just looked at like the sea of bags with a weird kind of like, not wonder, but just like a weird like mix of disgust. And she's like looking at me like, what is all this? And it's like, well, I'm stuffing stockings with them. And then she gave me that look that women give men well, just get on with it, Ben. Look,
get this shit out of the way.
Like, why is it sitting here? I'm so dumb and new to like trying to run a family that like that's like the difference between the magic of Christmas is it wrapped or not?
Yeah. You know? It's a mess if it's not fucking wrapped.
Yeah. And it's just like, lady, like I bought some shit and it's over there. Go pick out what you want. Like there's nothing magical about that. It has to be neatly labeled and wrapped. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Make it 8-year-old pretty. Ben? Make it pretty.
If it's not pretty, it's not magical. Lesson learned. I'm 40 years old. I'm an adult.
You're getting there. You're getting there.
Slowly, slowly but surely. This is going to be a fun episode because we're doing a very, very famous song with one of my favorite people. Let's just bring him in right now.
Let's bring him in.
My old dear friend, my attorney, Mr. Robin Weinburgh. Robin, are you there?
There he is. Hi. It looks like we spooked him. I'm going to ask to unmute.
Yeah, no, we're having the Zoom problem. Unmute it.
There he is.
There you go.
Oh crap, you already heard me.
No, it's fine. That was perfect. This is Robin Weinburgh, everybody. Robin is a stand-up comic, but more importantly, he's also an attorney these days. The man dropped the mic, picked up his quill pen, and became a barrister.
For the glamour.
Yes.
What are you drinking there, Robin?
Well, in celebration of today, as well as an early birthday present, went and bought myself Irish whiskey called Redbreast, which I had during my brief stay in Ireland. I was probably a bit too full of piss and vinegar and self-belief, and I went up to the bartender at the hotel we were staying in. I said, give me a shot of your finest Irish whiskey. Price is no problem. Ooh. He came back to me and said, well, a shot, $70. And I said, price is a problem.
Shit.
And he gave me the introductory level of Redbreast, which I quite enjoy.
Nice.
And so this is the top end.
Very nice. Well, I'm gonna go lower and just crack open a Guinness right here. I'm gonna do the pour.
It's the unmistakable sound of Dublin's best. Mm-hmm. This episode is gonna be very heavy on my ersatz Irish accent, I'm afraid.
Oh, I'm excited
because my
for that.
Irish accent is miserable.
Oh,
well,
my.
So is mine. Everybody's Irish accent's miserable. You just have to be fearless with it.
Everybody goes straight Lucky Charms. You immediately go there if you're an American and you know you're doing it and you know it's wrong and you're like, I can't get out.
I like to do like the very like languid, poetic Irish accent, like as if the Lucky Charms leprechaun is very, very high on heroin.
Let's hear it.
Frost my lucky charms. They're magically delicious. It's the best I can, well, the best I can do for you. Hey.
I like it. Man, we went to my husband's, my father-in-law has a house in Ireland, and we were there this time last year, and we met his neighbors, and his neighbor, Declan, they listened to the podcast, by the way. He is the most Irish person I've ever met, and he speaks so fast. So fast that I'm like, buddy, dude, you gotta stop. I am catching every 10th word, maybe. My skills of context clues were just like on like high alert anxiety, where I was just like, I have no idea what this fella's talking about. It was kind of fun.
I can do the Irish accent. It's a Scottish accent where I look at them and just go, I have no fucking idea. I really don't know.
Mine are equally bad, but there's no way, like, I can't toggle back and forth between them. Like, if I start out doing the Irish accent, we're staying in Ireland. Like, I can't swap around.
Yeah.
I'm, well, not a voice. Have you been to Scotland, Robin?
No, no. I've only been to Dublin, which is now one of my favorite cities in the world. We were there for about 3 days, and it was glorious. I would gladly go back there again.
Nice.
I would have gone farther, but I was afraid to drive on the wrong side of the road.
Yeah, I was going to say my father-in-law's house is like near, it's in closer to Galway. And I'm going to tell you now, Galway's even better. Like, you should go the other way.
we were going to drive over to Cork and see the cliffs of Moher, whatever. Yeah, but I'm a bit of a scared little boy.
Yeah, I didn't do any of the driving while we were there. And we almost hit a sheep. Like, all the roads are this narrow. They literally, and they just curve and everyone speeds. And there's no, like, you know how we have, like, I don't know, bike rail, like space. Mm-hmm. But they have brick wall, like stone walls. And there's, like, we took a corner one night and, like, this close to just having a sheep flip over our car. And the sheep are so dumb. They just stand there and look at you. They don't try to get out of the way. I was full on anxiety. I would never try to drive there.
They're not dumb. They're Irish. They're sheep who are just, like at war with cars, right? This has been our roads for thousands of years. We won't be giving them up to you so easily.
This is awesome.
Laid down for no automobile.
At some point we should, I mean, they know because they clicked on it, but we should tell the listeners why we're talking about Ireland so much.
Because we're gonna do the song today is Fairytale of New York by the Pogues.
I'm so excited. I'm just so Christmassy right now. I'm Ireland and I'm Christmassy, and I'm just so excited to do this song.
Hang on a second. I'm gonna have
Christmas nonsense in the background as well, but there would have been a very real risk of us being interrupted by a two-year-old. So repeatedly.
Are we
keeping our voices down? Is this our second Christmas?
No. Huh? This is...
No, I mean, is this Alta's second Christmas? Your daughter's second Christmas?
Third. The first one was the best time because she was 5-6 months old, so yeah. You could just put her on the ground and wander off forever and not worry about
what's that the best it was the best when I could just put him in that little boppy thing and be like, ugh! Like, he can't do anything, he can't go anywhere,
right? we had one like that, but we called it her office because it had little doodads for her to play with and everything else. And then one day we left her in there just a little bit longer than perhaps we should have.
Uh-oh.
And there was no more office after that. Besmirched.
She's like, fuck this place.
Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm.
Exactly.
Mm. Guys, look at that. Look how pretty that is. I mean, come on. It's just
And for those of you who've not been to Ireland, it really is true. The Guinnesses are better there.
They are.
They just fucking are. I don't know why. Accept it.
Did you do the Guinness tour? Oh, yeah. You have to. And honestly... It's gorgeous. They've done a beautiful job with it. It's like the prettiest museum I've ever seen.
Mm-hmm. We literally got in the car, the taxi, and said, take us to Guinness. I mean, almost, we went to the airport just long enough to throw our stuff in the room and then went to the tour.
Nice.
And that was all, I mistakenly referred to England and Ireland as being the same place in context. It made sense. And I think the driver nearly turned around and punched me.
Nice. All right. Well, let's talk about the drunkest man, the drunkest Irish man in history who writes amazing music.
The drunkest Irishman in New York. You want to dive into the lyrics? Let's just get started.
Sure.
This is Fairytale of New York by the Pogues featuring Christy McCall. I'm going to try not to, but I'm definitely going to snap in and out of my dumb Irish accent. I apologize.
Right. It was Christmas Eve, babe, in the drunk tank, an old man said to me, won't see another one.
Right. It was Christmas Eve, babe, in the drunk tank, an old man said to me, won't see another one. So establishing a very Irish scene here, aren't we?
Yes, yes.
There are only four lines in. It's Christmas Eve. He's drunk. He's in jail. There's an old man in there who's being, that's the most Irish saying I think ever. Won't see another one, you know.
Won't see another one.
Starting off with the weepiness.
If you watch the video, which I just did for the first time, they have the scene where it's an old man. And the old man is like this 42-year-old guy.
Yeah.
And speaking as a guy's about to turn 50, I was like, fuck you.
Fuck you, dude. Yeah.
Totally.
I get it. Happened to us more and more often. Yeah. When, a couple of years ago when they said, oh yeah, we're gonna do old Batman. I was like, oh, that's gonna be awesome. You'll get like Harrison Ford, you'll get Clint Eastwood. It's like, it's Ben Affleck. I'm like, Ben Affleck is Batman's correct age.
Oh my god.
And then he sang a song, the rare old mountain tune. I turned my face away and dreamed about you.
And then he sang a song, the rare old mountain dew. Robin, what's the rare old mountain dew?
What the fuck is that?
I mean, everything I've learned about this song, I've learned in the past 48 hours. I was not a Pogues guy. I just knew this song and I loved this song. The Rare Old Mountain Dew is a song within the song. It's an Irish folk tune that's basically about, let's all get relaxed, sit outside, enjoy the weather, and get a little snackered on this whiskey, which they're calling the Rare Old Mountain Dew.
Okay.
Oh.
I know. It's way to just play into the stereotype.
I checked like five different websites to make sure that lyric was right, because I'm thinking the hillbilly drink Mountain Dew, and I'm like, what? I don't understand how this has made it into the song. This has to be a misheard song lyric, but thank you for clarifying.
No, absolutely. It caught me weird as well for the same reason.
I was like, what? No, don't talk about Mountain Dew in this.
So now, there's an old man.
I was just going to say.
Go ahead.
They almost named the song, apparently, or at least like Elvis Costello recommended that they name this song allegedly Christmas Day in the Drunk Tank.
I like it. I mean, it's not named that, but it's that. So yeah.
It's a very Elvis Costello type song, Christmas Eve in the Drunk Tank would be a very, because we did an episode about Morrissey a little while ago, and Elvis Costello's big stinging clap at Morrissey was just like, the guy writes great song titles, but he doesn't write great songs. So it's almost like Elvis Costello's trying to do like the reverse end around on Shane McGowan. Like, you're going to write great songs, but I'm going to christen them with horrible names for you. The Rare Old Mountain Dew, I Turned My Face Away and Dreamed About You. So that's a common thing for Irish figures in literature, to be in jail on major holidays, drunk off their asses, but still thinking about you, love. Still my heart is in the right place. My body might be in prison, but they can't imprison my mind. Or my love.
Got on the lucky one. Came in 18 to 1. I've got a feeling this year's for me and you. when all our dreams come true.
Got on a lucky one, came in 18-1. This is horse racing, obviously. Mm-hmm. I've got a feeling this year's for me and you. So happy Christmas. I love you, baby. I can see a better time when all our dreams come true. And this is where the song starts. it starts picking up with the below decks on the Titanic dancing, Irish clog dancing.
It's all Irish and shit. It blows up.
That's how we need to say it. It gets all Irish and shit at this point.
Exactly. You guys are so goddamn poor. Where are all the violins coming from? Violins are expensive. And that's just the violin itself, not even the violin lessons. There's a lot there. And you have to have somebody who knows how to play the violin in your town. I'm just saying that when it comes to Irish, they may have a poverty of money, but they don't have a poverty of intellect or ability.
Let me tell you this. I went to Ireland and all of my generalizations about Ireland came true so fast. And maybe it's just where we were, but like a herd of sheep came through our yard within the first hour that I was there. And we were like in the country, and then we went to a bar that night, and maybe because it was Christmas, I don't know if it's like this all the time, maybe because it was in the country, but it was like midnight. Like my son goes to bed at 7:30, and there were kids in the bar eating chocolate and orange juice, and everyone had a fucking instrument. kids with their parents, and they're just playing these songs and like all these different instruments. And I was like, I felt like Funny Farm. Remember when like they're trying to get all the people at Funny Farm to play nice, to get the people to buy their house, like play along, make it look like a great little town. I was like, is this all put on for me? Is this real?
There's some Americans coming to town. Everybody wash up.
All the kids were so polite and so well-mannered and so smart, and they all knew how to play an instrument and up past their bedtime. It was just bizarre, and I loved every second of it.
All right, everybody, put on your Sunday best. Let's be a little more Oscar Wilde and a little less Conor McGregor.
That's a country that's well aware that their money comes from tourism.
Yeah. All right, let's keep going.
Doo-doo.
They got cars big as bars. They got rivers of gold. But the wind goes right through you. It's no place for the old. When you first took my hand on a cold Christmas Eve, you promised me Broadway was waiting for me.
They've got cars big as bars. They've got rivers of gold, but the wind goes right through you. It's no place for the old. And this is where the duet starts happening, right? Like this is a hugely, hugely, hugely famous song in the United Kingdom, like to the point where if anybody's listening to it there, they must be like, do you really need to go through this so slowly? Do you not hear it 100 times every Christmas? No, we don't. But we really should.
Well, let me just say, so they're talking about New York at this point. They're describing New York, and they've got cars big as bars. Okay. They've got rivers of gold. And I'm like, what are they talking? Like, that's hobo piss. Like, what are you talking about? What are the rivers of gold?
That's just good old fashioned vomit, blood and urine.
Exactly.
Just like you've got back home in Limerick. Don't you feel at home?
Step right over that. Ugh. Yeah.
Well, what's funny about this song is, at least, you know, they wrote this song for like 2 years. They just kind of, they couldn't get it to quite work and change the lyrics and all that. When they initially started writing this, they hadn't been to New York. They had never been to New York. So they had no idea what New York was. In 85 was when they started this. They were touring Europe, and apparently Shane and some other guy were like watching religiously this movie called Once Upon a Time in America.
Okay. Yes.
All about Jewish mafia in New York. And you know, that perhaps colored what they considered New York to be. I read that line being like, all right, there's, oh, well, hold on. I'm jumping ahead on the next line.
Okay, let's keep going. Also, are those stickers on your shoulder? Like, did your daughter give you that?
Yeah, sorry. It's
adorable.
God damn it.
All right, yeah.
I have some dad honor boards here that have been clipped on me. Yeah. Straighten up, dad. When you first took my hand on a cold Christmas Eve, you promised me Broadway was waiting for me. So grand young dreams. Like, I think we're, yeah, I mean, it comes up a little bit later, but obviously this is a flashback. Like, I think in terms of the song in present day, he's in his jail cell he's in his drunk tank in New York, but now he's reflecting on a long life and a long marriage that has clearly had its ups and downs. You promised me Broadway was waiting for me.
You were pretty queen of New York City. When the band finished playing, they held out for more. Sinatra was swinging, all the jokes they were singing. We kissed on the corner, then danced through the night.
You were handsome, you were pretty, queen of New York City. This is a duet. They held out for more. Sinatra was swinging. So they're setting the stage. Sinatra's swinging. So this is like the 40s New York. They're Broadway stars in the 40s. All the drunks they were singing, we kissed on a corner, then danced through the night. So happy days.
Those were the good days, ma'am.
Young love.
Any story that involves horse gambling can't turn bad.
Starts in a drunk tank and goes to horse gambling. It's going to have a happy ending, right?
Let's continue this happy ride. The gist of it, I think, at least in the second stanza, is that, you know, New York has a sort of duality to it. It can be fantastic if you're wealthy and successful, but you know, it's probably going to suck for most people.
I lived there 1 month and I was like, get me the fuck out of here.
I've been there twice in my life, and after the second day, I'm like, I can't. I have to get somewhere else. I have to get back to the South.
Yeah, you get tired of smelling human urine all day. I was like, I would run to Central Park just to breathe in nature. Because I'm like, all I can smell is trash and hobo piss. I'm sick of it. Take me home.
But just being at home, drink every time Diane says hobo.
R.I.P. hobo.
Just being that close to people too is something that's new for me. Like you know, everywhere I've lived, there's always been like space. There's been room to move. You know, there's like big buildings and stuff. Like in New York, like you're literally, like, you go to a restaurant, like it'll be a table for two, and it might as well be a table for eight because your elbows in, your shoulders hunched. Mm-hmm. People you don't know are having incredibly intimate conversations half a foot away from you. It's really strange.
Yeah. You know, there's parts in all of that part I knew about and it didn't bother me. It was like little things, like if you go to a grocery store, the aisles are this big and like you don't have a car, so you have to think about what you're getting and like only take enough that you can actually carry on the subway home or whatever. If you're, you know, you have to walk with it. And then I was just like, I just want the fucking luxury of my house next to an HEB again. Like, I'm sorry. If you grow up in Texas, you're spoiled and you want it back.
I want a front and a backyard.
You were talking about the duality of New York, where it's you know, the haves and the have nots and the rich and the poor. But I think part of the reason why they chose New York is because it speaks to the duality of Christmas as well. Like Christmas is very much a have and have not kind
very
of thing.
Very much.
Like, if you have a happy family and you have a wee bit of eggnog and some good friends and some good cheer, then it's a good day for you. You don't. Yeah.
This is a very depressing time of year for a lot of people. We'll get into that more after we get through these lyrics.
You just need we'll get some depression. Rare old Mountain Dew.
Cheers, Robin. Have a red breast. There you go.
It's all cheers.
There you go, boy.
That's the extent of my accent.
The boys of the NYPD choir were singing going by, and the bells are ringing out for Christmas Day.
The boys of the NYPD choir were singing Galway Bay. Diane, do you know Galway Bay?
I've been to Galway and I saw water. Is that, I don't know the song.
if you've seen Galway Bay, then you know, like if you've heard like any Irish folk music, or if you've watched like An American Tale, or like, anytime the Irish best friend character starts singing his sad old song of the old country, it's Galway Bay.
Okay. Okay. I've seen American Tale. And Fife Will Goes West.
The boys of the NYPD choir were singing Galway Bay, and the bells were ringing out for Christmas Day. I can't get that Shane McGowan rasp in my voice. I'm going to go scream into a pillow for a little while so I can come out and get, and the bells were ringing out for Christmas Day.
There's, you need a lot more substance abuse to get his voice.
Yeah, right. I'm gonna smoke a cigarette between all of my fingers by the end of this podcast. And of course, the NYPD is just full of Irish people, right?
Absolutely. See, I this is probably my favorite part of the entire song. I actually wrote next to this, you know, that I love this particular little four-line combo.
Where they turn on each other?
Yeah, I don't know. I read it in like a bunch of different ways. You know, the boys of the NYPD choir, are they being literal? Are they, you know, talking about this is all the Irish people in the drunk tank or getting together and singing Galway Bay to remember the old country, if you will.
Yeah, I did. Okay, I just thought of when they say the NYPD choir, I just figured that they meant like the cops, the New York City cops. There's, I guess they probably refer to everybody in the New York City jail as the NYPD choir.
Yeah.
Everybody on Rikers is the NYPD choir.
Yeah, no, I took it as like, you know, back in the days you could walk the streets and like the NYPD choir, which doesn't exist, but they pretended it did, would actually get out and perform for civilians.
I don't know. I like that too.
Yeah, that would be nice.
Really? The handsome men of New York's finest are here to sing you a Christmas tune. It's called Get Down on Your Belly.
Although to be fair, when we were in New York the last time, we were in Brooklyn or kind of close to Prospect Park, and there was the New York Police Department Steel Drum Band.
Yeah, exactly. They have the Marine Corps band. I just pictured it as something like that.
I can't believe they don't have a choir. They can, if they can cobble together enough policemen to play the Jamaican steel drums.
Steel drums, yeah. Can,
exactly.
Is that a way that you can backdoor your way into the NYPD? Like, I'm not big, I'm not tough. I really have no sense of right or wrong whatsoever, but I can play the steel drums.
I'll just go ahead and say this now in the research. The NYPD doesn't actually have a choir, although they do have an Irish pipe band that is featured in the music video. Mm-hmm. The pipe band didn't know Galway Bay, so they played the Mickey Mouse Club march instead, and the promo was later slowed down to fit the beat. Go ahead, Robin.
So you only watched I watched the video just before because I realized I had never seen it. Aside from a brief cameo by Matt Dillon, it's like, what? Yeah, you're right. They show them for like 2 seconds. They're just kind of standing there with a big drum that says pipe band. That's all they do.
But listen to this. Here's why. The pipe band had been drinking on the couch, on the coach that brought them to the video shoot. By the time they turned up for filming, they were even more drunk than the Pogues themselves and refused to appear unless they were given more alcohol. I don't know if that's true, but let's just go with it because that's really funny.
That's a high five. The Pogues arrested them.
That's so a high funny. Five and call a cab. It's a night over. We're drunker than the Pogues. Let's get out of here.
I'm not sure who'd be more excited to party with the other.
Yeah, seriously. I mean, they are people. They are people. Mm-hmm. All right, let's get to the most fun part of the song.
You're a bum, you're a punk. You're an old slut and junk lying there, almost dead on a drip in that bed. You scumbag, you maggot, you cheap, lousy faggot. Happy Christmas, you're all sod, my God, it's our love. You're a bum, you're a punk, you're an old slut and junk lying there, almost dead on a drip in that bed. You scumbag, you maggot, you cheap, lousy faggot. Happy Christmas, you're ours. I pray to God it's our last.
What happened?
Yeah.
What happened?
Yeah. 30 years of drunkenness is what happened, Diane.
It's amazing. Oh my gosh. I love the feeling of like, you scumbag, you maggot, like my ass. Like, I just love like how she's like all of this was so dreamy and such a wonderful, like dreamy past, but like, no, here's the reality, you piece of shit.
And it's awesome. Like Robin was saying, like Shane McGowan took 2 years writing the lyrics for this song to make sure that they're perfect, that they flow correctly. And this is like, it's like Dr. Seuss. I want to go around because it's so much fun. Like Diane, do it. Just read that verse, but get into it. Like hear the beat.
You scumbag, you maggot, you cheap, lousy faggot. Happy Christmas to your ass. I pray God it's our last.
Doesn't it just feel great? It flows so trippingly off the tongue.
It really does. She's been waiting a long time. Actually, it doesn't sound like she's been waiting a long time to say it. It sounds like a bitch who says this to this fucking punk every day.
I think it's one or the other. I think it's either every day or this is the dam bursting. Like I could also see it being 30 years of him like making his way home, like he's all drunk and lost the money on the horses. Like they don't come in at 8 to 1 every day. And it's just like, oh, but I've changed. Nothing's changed about, I still love you. I may be broke, but like, okay, fine. He loves me. And then one day,
fuck! Fuck. Get these Target bags off the counter. Robin, you missed that part when Ben did his opener. He was talking about his girlfriend was annoyed at all the shit he had bought, and it was for a good reason. It was to stuff stockings, but she's like, what's all this fucking shit everywhere?
She wasn't being unreasonable. It was just like, I bought all the stuff, but then I hadn't bothered to wrap it. Like it's just all just sitting in bags. Like I'm gonna wait for Christmas Eve just to wrap it up. Like I don't care about it at all. So when she was upset, it was just like, I finally understood that the reason that you wrap up a gift is to show that you give a fuck about what you're doing. And if it's just sitting there in your room, like it's just in bags with a receipt, everything like that. It's just like, what are you doing? You don't love anybody. You're just shopping.
Yeah.
I can think back like every relationship I was in to like the one moment when I said, when that moment happened, that's when everything started rolling downhill. It's like really, really minor. Like,
do you have an example?
Like I'm from the South. So, you know, if y'all know me, I'm more inclined, you know, I'm quick to say, I'm sorry and thank you and you're welcome. And I can't help doing that.
And you're a Georgia peach.
Yeah. And I was dating a girl who was from Ohio and we'll get into this later perhaps, but you know, I thought I was being a very good boyfriend and helpful and getting stuff and all that. And one day I think I just was like, she never said thank you. And that just kind of nagged at me. And then one day I said, you know, you could say thank you more. And that's the moment when I like, okay, that's when the relationship died.
But I'm with you. I get furious. Like it's that David Byrne line. I hate people when they're not polite. Like, say thank you.
It's the wrapping of the present. It's that little bit of care.
And wrap it nice.
Obviously, I don't think we can talk about this particular verse of the song without addressing the controversy therein.
The debate.
The debate. Okay, so apparently the BBC is divided into several different entities, and apparently on BBC One, which in my mind, and maybe I'm very wrong about this, but I think BBC Radio One is like the more standard, like uniform national radio station. And on BBC One, they edit it so it doesn't say "you cheap, lousy faggot." It says "you're cheap, lousy, and haggard" or something like that. Like they're trying to get the F word out of there. Right. Which I think is a noble instinct.
I get it. I mean, I get it. I understand that to the homosexual community, that is their N word, you know, especially in the ways that it has been used while they're taking a beating, some gay bashing. Like, I get it. But that is not how it's used in this song, you know, and I will say, I don't know if you guys read this. I like McGowan's response to it. A couple things. He said, there's no political correctness to it. I've been told it's insulting to gays. I don't understand how that works. Nobody in this band thinks that's worth a second thought. And then he adds, the word was used by the character because it fitted with the way she would speak and with her character. She is not supposed to be a nice person or even a wholesome person. She is a woman of a certain generation at a certain time in history, and she is down on her luck and desperate. She's not a racist. I mean, not racist. She's not a gay basher, you know?
Yeah, I mean, I think if you're going to have an issue with the word, don't change the word. Just take it out.
Yeah.
And I'm with you. Being of my age, there are words that I still use that now I realize I probably shouldn't.
Right.
You know, I still fight, you know, when I grew up, you used the word gay to mean stupid.
Exactly.
And I've had to force that out of my repertoire, if you will. So,
or yeah, lame. Like when something's just lame, I'm like, oh, it's gay. And I'm like, right. I'm not thinking at all about a homosexual person. It's like the word has a completely different meaning in this way. But
yeah. Yeah. But I mean, I understand the feeling. And if someone's feeling offended by something, it's easier for me to change the word than for you to get over decades or generations of abuse and neglect.
Right.
And so I'm fine with omitting the word in certain contexts.
Right.
But don't change. Still have respect for the guy who put together the poetry of it all.
Mm-hmm. Right.
But
it's also kind of strange because this isn't really the sort of case that I'm talking about, but there's adult entertainment, right? Like there's things that are meant to be aimed at, when I say adult entertainment, I don't mean, you know, I mean like it's geared at adults, right? Like people 18 or over, it's geared for people who are capable of having that conversation. So it's almost like, instead of censoring the song, do we just need to make sure that there are stronger filters so that, you know, you're not
making sure kids aren't hearing it. Yeah. And what I feel like the people are losing nowadays, especially, is that not only is there an adult filter, there's a comedy filter where it's like, stop taking everything so serious. Know when a joke is a joke. Like, oh God, I
totally agree with you. I think we've talked about this before, but to me, it cuts both ways. Like I'm not a stand-up anymore, and I wasn't very successful when I was, but it seems to me that part of being a comic is knowing where the line is, right? And knowing like which jokes you can drop on which side of the line.
Yeah.
So to me, it seems like a real advantage to comedians to have a really clearly drawn line. Like if everybody knows exactly where the line is, then there's no back and forth about it. Like these discussions can really only be good.
Perfect comic. You know, last week y'all were talking about, or Kristen was telling the story of Sean Rouse and the mother with the cut off the arms, and you know, he found where that line was, like he was such a genius at doing, versus the other person who I know exactly who she was talking about, who just found a way to find the line, kick it over, and then take a dump on it.
Yeah, exactly.
And, you know, always go like way over.
Yeah, like doing it just for the sake of shock value, where a good comedian knows how to make the person who's ready to be offended laugh instead. Like, it's just got to be really funny, you know, but.
And good songwriters as well. Like I think that's what Shane McGowan is doing here. Like if you're a woman and you want to insult your husband,
you want to punch it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But really the hardest way that your longtime lover can hit the male ego is to say that you never got me there.
Yeah, exactly. It's like when we did Lush and we did that song, she was talking about, oh wait, that was opposite. She actually said the only thing he did good was in bed. But I mean, you just want to go for the throat. You want to hit him where it hurts, and that's what she's doing with this lyric. This is not.
I think most of my arguments have ended when one of us stepped over the line and said something that actually made you go, "Oh shit, I just fucked up."
You're like, I just hurt your feelings for real. I'm sorry. Yeah.
But the point being is, you get angry enough, and you know, it's no longer about winning the argument, it's about hurting the other person, and that's when something like this comes out.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And it's so fitting for this couple and this song.
Well, I guess at some point too, you know, we'll talk about the timing, you know, when did the song supposedly take place, how is time played around within it, but you know, the references to Sinatra and all that. This was a different time than 87 when it was released. It was, you know, Sinatra was swinging 40s and 50s, and well, white people were not the best of folks back then.
No, nope. We said whatever the fuck we wanted. This was not the worst word of the day back then.
Yeah.
I feel like that they still have the argument around that they have the argument every year around the words in this song means that reasonable people are winning. Like that's a good compromise. Like, okay, like you get to keep the song and you get to keep it as written, but we're also having the discussion about it, and that's good too. Nobody's going to be able to hear this song without knowing why certain words are making certain people upset.
Right.
I mean, my understanding is that, you know, like you alluded to earlier, Ben, there's multiple BBCs. you know, BBC One, I think they edit it, but then the other BBCs that are more adult contemporary or whatever the hell it calls it, you know, they play the unedited version because it's a different audience.
Yes.
Mm.
So you can kind of pick and choose your poison, for lack of a better way of saying it.
Right.
I wonder if that's the way that you insult lame kids in England. Like, ah, oh, he's so BBC One. He'll never be Radio 4.
Right.
The boys of the NYPD choir still sing in Galway Bay, and the bells are ringing out for Christmas Day. I have to say, ring it out. Ring it out. You're ringing it out, boyo. This is my favorite part of the song.
I love this part.
I could have been someone.
Well, so could anyone. You took my dreams from me when I first found you.
I kept them with me, babe. I put them with my own. Can't make it all alone. I built my dreams around you.
I could have been someone.
Well, so could anyone. Well, that's the biggest, like, go fuck yourself. So can anyone. Yeah.
And I'm absolutely convinced that it's meant to tie back to the great line from On the Waterfront, the famous Marlon Brando, I could have been a contender speech. It just echoes so much in my head. And with all the talk of like the Pogues watching New York movies, like Once Upon a Time in America, it's hard for me to think, because that's a real classic speech about sort of the American character and about, you know, two-fisted New York City characters. I could have been a contender. To have that sting and rebuke back, well, so could anyone. It takes all the magic out of that. We're like, you're not special.
Yeah.
You ruined it yourself.
Yeah.
I could have been someone. Well, so could anyone. You took my dreams from me when I first found you. I just love the way this lyric comes together. You took my dreams from me when I first found you. I mean, that's the thing that, like, there's been times in my life where I've been terrified of doing that to somebody, where you're just like, I'm not gonna be the person that you think I'm gonna turn into. Like, I just know, like maybe it's my self-hating and self-defeating tendencies, but I'm just like, I just don't feel like I've got the responsibility or the strength of character to take on someone else's dreams, right? It's absolutely terrifying. That's why I'm not married. It's why I don't have kids. It really comes down to that. It says, you took my dreams from me when I first found you. And then that's her talking. And then he says, I kept them with me, babe. I put them with my own. Can't make it all alone. I've built my dreams around you. It's just like, I don't know. You to get three quarters of the way through the song and have her calling him, you know, an old wretched faggot or whatever it is, and she's an old slut on junk. Like, how are they going to win it back within a couple of rhyming couplets? And somehow, through the magic of Irish mysticism, he does it.
It happens so fast. It's like the best fucking editing of a song I've ever seen.
Mm-hmm. It's absolutely insane.
What's interesting, you know, the part about you took my dreams from me, kind of, you know, if the story was that they were in Ireland, he won money at the track, and so he said, hey, this is our year, let's go to New York City. You know, it kind of alludes to, all right, well, what was going on back in Ireland when they moved? What were her dreams? Did she even want to go to New York in the first place? Is he filling her full of promises and whatever else, you know, if she wanted a family or anything like that? You know, did she give that up to come with him on this little New York trip, and now she's stuck here? It speaks to kind of like what else could be going on in the story that's not directly addressed.
Yeah, I mean, that I go back to that line, Broadway was waiting for me. Like, maybe she wanted to be a singer or some kind of you know, actor or dancer, and then they got there and he's just a bum and a punk and squandered money, and she's an old slut on junk, like nothing. I think the blame is on both of them. They didn't really try hard.
Right.
Their dreams died together.
Yeah.
And it's possible too, you know, that first line about you were handsome, you're pretty, queen of New York City, you know, they came, they partied, they spent all their money.
Yeah.
And now they're broke and Irish in New York in the 1940s.
Yep.
Which is not a good place to be.
And New York will do that to you at any age in any decade. You bleed money there. I mean, it just, it will suck the life out of you. They didn't have a fucking chance.
Mm-hmm. I think this song takes place over the course of a couple of decades. Like, I don't think that this is like a year or 18 months or like, I don't think this is like two, like 25 or 26 year old people saying, you know, you're a faggot, you're a drunk. Like, I think it's 20 years of like, I think this, most love songs are like that bang of first meeting and then making promises and maybe it ends on the wedding day or something like that. But nobody talks about the work that comes in after. Like, that's, yeah, we rely on country music for that one to talk about like 25 and 30 year old, you know, love affairs. I think that's what this is. It's just like, that's like, there must be a point in every marriage or several points in every marriage or every long-term relationship where you're 5 years down the road, 15 years down the road, looking at each other like, this is not what I expected. Is it still good for you?
Right. Yeah.
As someone who has been married before, I will neither confirm nor deny.
I forgot about that. I always forget that Mungle was married before too. That always drops my jaw when I'm like, oh my God, you were married. I've only ever known, like, I met you and Rob after your divorces. So I've only ever known you guys not married. And then I saw you get married.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you know, Ben, you were talking earlier, but you don't want to take on some, you know, you don't want to take someone's dreams from them. When I met my current wife, you know, I was already making plans at that time to move to New York with Jerry Wayne. Mm-hmm. And we had made serious plans. We had talked about it, and I was saving up money and all of that. And I was dating my now wife at the time. And she said, all right, well, if you move to New York, I'm going to go with you. And all of a sudden, everything changed. All of a sudden, everything was like, all right, now I'm not only responsible for screwing up my own life if this fails,
yep,
but for screwing up other people's lives. And I had to really seriously examine, what do I think is the percentage chance that I, Robin Weinburgh, medium fish in a small pond, am going to do, who doesn't like hanging around club owners, who doesn't like networking, who doesn't like dealing with people? How is New York going to treat me?
Mm. Yeah.
I'm like, you know what? I think I'll be a lawyer.
Well, it's funny that, you know, you were able to see that so clearly. You were very forward thinking, and you also knew that you loved her and wanted that to work out. Because a lot of guys would be like, comedy's more important than this relationship. But you were like, no, I think this relationship's more important than comedy. I'm going to do whatever makes this work, actually.
Well, yeah, I realize that deep down, and I don't mean to make this into, you know, what happened before, but, you know, I think deep down I realized that what I really wanted was, I wanted a house and I wanted a kid and I wanted to stay at home. And, you know, I had lived my life in bars. You know, yeah. I don't know about you, Diane, I don't know about you, Ben, but, well, Ben, obviously you, I think I told you, I don't like going in bars.
Yeah.
I just don't. The moment I walk in, I'm just like, oh, I need to leave. I just feel that, you know, there's this sort of innate sense that says, get the fuck out of here.
Yeah.
And I can't help that.
Mm-hmm. I have the exact opposite and I can't help it.
Well, I mean, I kept the important details. So yeah, I understand the point about, you know, taking on someone's dreams. And for me personally, I think if you're going to get married, you have to, that has to happen. If we're going to have a long-term relationship, it can't be your dreams are here and her dreams are here. And so I think that's why this, to tie it back into the song, why this particular stanza works so well.
Yeah.
You know, because to me, it's super romantic. It's super powerful. It's, you know, and maybe other people might mock it, but to me, it is powerful.
Yeah.
Yeah. You go on an emotional ride with these two. You see the dreamy beginning, you see like where it got ugly and hard, and then you see in the end that, like, oh, he just loves her though, you know, mm-hmm. and she probably actually loved him too.
We don't know. We don't know what happened.
Yeah.
That's part of the beauty of the song. It's like, all right, you know, this is all from his perspective. There's very little that she ever says other than you're a bum and a punk and the well, so could anyone. You know, for all we know, he's in the drunk tank because he spent all his money, went to her front door, knocked on it loudly drunk at 4 a.m. and screamed out all of these things. And she said, go fuck yourself. And he went and drank some more and ended up in the drunk tank.
Yeah. Yeah. I still think there's a chance that she's like, but this is my fucking dude. I can talk to him like this.
Yeah. I like to think she took him back too.
Yeah.
Yeah. This is foreplay. This is their love language.
Yeah. Did you guys know that Shane McGowan was born on Christmas Day?
Mm-hmm. I did know that.
Isn't
yeah.
that fun? It just makes the song great.
Yeah. And you were saying earlier, Ben, I mean, this song charts every year in England and Ireland for 17 years. Come Christmas time. You know, it's... There's a debate about even between politicians and Pogues and so forth, but whether it should even be considered a Christmas song. People on the, I don't know what they call the right wing, the is it Tories?
The Tories of the right wing party, yeah.
Okay. Yeah. They had some Tory members who were tweeting about how it was an awful disgrace that this was considered to be, you know, one of the national Christmas songs, I guess, because of the lyrics and the Pogues history and
kids. Whatever. I can't stand it when people get a stick up their ass. It's one of the best Christmas songs ever. Mm-hmm. They don't all have to be Perry Como. Let's have some shit.
I think Shane responded by using some sort of English slang for you're a Nazi. I forgot exactly what the word is.
He said Pogues Mahomes.
Yeah.
I don't even know if I said that right. Is that the phrase? Pogues Mahome, kiss my arse.
I don't know. I've only heard it from Irish Americans. I've always heard Pog Mahone.
Pog Mahone.
Yeah, but that's not from sources I trust. That's from drunken redheads.
No, I think that's probably actually more right. I think I remember reading something like that. God, we should have like previous guest Brian Gallagher on here just popping in every now and then to correct us.
Just to set the record straight. Just to reach through the screen and punch me every time I try my Irish accent.
That's offensive, Ben.
Like an SNL Fox and Friends thing. Someone comes on and scrolls up all the things we got wrong.
It'd be great. It'd be great.
The Pogues are not from Des Moines, Iowa.
It'd be great to like film two Irish people watching this podcast and just listening to their commentary. Just like, God damn it.
Face
oh, I hope that Mowbray doesn't do another Irish accent.
We're doing our best. God, I text my husband if he'd bring me another Guinness like 10 minutes ago and he's ignoring it. God damn it.
That's why I brought the bottle.
I should have done that.
There you go. All right, Robin, here we go. It's a Christmas toast to you.
Hi.
I'm going to tell you that I'm drinking Irish whiskey, but it's English rum. Clink.
Clink. Oh.
Let's call Corbin on speakerphone. This is good podcasting, right?
Oh, absolutely.
I'm sure there'll be no
feedback. It's good Irish podcasting. So you call him up and then your drunk friends will just yell at him.
Mm-hmm. Hey, you're live on the podcast. Say hi to... Okay.
Hey, would you bring us some beer in here for the love of God? We're dying of thirst.
Oh, shit, I have headphones on. He can't hear you guys. Can I have a Guinness, please?
Corbin's a bum and a punk. He's an old slut on junk.
He's like, hello? Hello? Oh, that was good. I don't even know if he's bringing it. I don't know what he said. All right.
Oh, he'll be bringing it up.
What else we got, guys?
I think that's our New York fairy tale. I think we nailed it.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's pretty good. Let's see. Something fun that I wanted to say. Oh, that was just a really funny Rolling Stone magazine article that described the song as the musical equivalent of a pub crawl, which I thought was funny.
I wanted to get on my high horse for a second. Meme that's going around about how baby it's cold outside is offensive, but WAP is perfectly fine. Isn't that all wrong? I fucking hate that because, yeah. Oh, did he? Yes, he did bring me Guinness.
Yeah, he looks annoyed with me. I was like, come here, be on the podcast. And he's just shaking his head.
He's like, once was enough.
I can hear more of Ben's bullshit. There's no need for that. I don't like that argument. I don't like baby, it's cold outside is offensive because taking a woman's sexual decision-making from her in the 1960s is not at all the same as a woman celebrating her sexual decision-making in 2020. They're completely different. And if you can't see that, get the fuck out of the conversation.
Yeah, I agree.
Well, and I think at the same time, the whole argument of saying, well, this should be okay because this other offensive thing is also, I mean, if something in and of itself is offensive, it's in and of itself offensive. One bad deed isn't made good by somebody else's bad deed. It's still a bad deed.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Oh, God.
Thankfully, I haven't heard that argument because all I listened to were Coco Melon and Wiggles songs.
And Robin, one day soon, those days will be over and you'll be back to regular music. Like, I'm pretty much there. There's no more baby shark in this house. It's good. Now all I hear are like weird Minecraft and Super Mario stuff coming from the video game.
I can live with that. I spent 2.5 years deliberately not introducing all baby shark. Somebody, either her school or her nana, did that, and I will hunt them down and kill their family. Unless their families meet. but she is taken to asking for that all the time.
Oh, it's a catty tune.
Mm-hmm, thank God Sesame Street did a version of that with Cookie Monster, who I can listen to all day, every day. Or I would be much angrier than I already am.
I like it. I actually had it as a guilty pleasure song early on because of the baseball player that does it for his kid. And I was just like, well, that's heartwarming.
Yeah, fuck Boston. For those people in Boston who want to be upset, you can send your complaints to charliekennedy.com. I also hate Jesus and Bon Jovi and kittens.
You had some thoughts on Bon Jovi, yes.
Yes. Bon Jovi did a cover of this song recently, this year.
Yeah.
And I know when I heard it, I was so aghast. I think I sent you a link, Ben. I don't know if you actually listened to it.
Probably not. But
it is hands down perhaps the, well, I'll put it this way. One of the responses to it on Twitter was, and I forgot who it was who did this. It may have been the producer of this song who said, this is the worst thing that ever happened in the history of music. And I'm including the shooting of John Lennon.
This is the worst thing.
Child cry. Christmas is ruined. Unquote.
So
this
you've
is
listened
the worst
to
thing
it.
That the Italians have ever done to the Irish in New York City.
What?
So does he do it with a woman, like duet style?
Yeah, is it a duet?
You know how when you're listening to a song on the radio and you're kind of singing along and the singer has an accent, so you kind of like, you know, like you're listening to the Banana Boat song by Harry Belafonte. You can't help but do this really shitty imitation of whatever accent Harry Belafonte is sporting in that. To me, I didn't listen to Bon Jovi. I don't like Bon Jovi. So I don't know what he normally sounds like in his music, but to me, he sounds like he's trying to present the sort of bad Irish accent while he's singing the song, but also kind of singing like Henry Phillips does. We sort of like that very breathy singing when he's kind of making fun of.
Oh shit, mm-hmm. I have to listen to it now.
But to answer your question, no. He sings both parts of the song.
What?
So you have Bon Jovi singing the you know, the I could have been someone, well, so could anyone.
Does he say the F word?
No. Point three. Sorry, I'm really upset about this.
Okay.
He changed the entire stanza. So just remember, the original one is you're a bum, you're a punk, you're an old slut on... Well, here, Diane, if you want to do it, I don't know.
Oh, I just put my lyrics in the trash. You're an old
slut. You're a bum, you're a punk.
You're an old slut on junk. Lying there almost dead on a drip in that bed. You scumbag, you maggot, you cheap, lousy faggot. Happy Christmas, you're our Saturday. God, it's our last. That's what it is in the original for those of you who've lost track. He changed it to, where did I put it down? You're a bum, you're a braggart. You've lost all your swagger.
Hey.
And the word around town is you ain't much in bed.
Oh my God.
You're a squirrel because you're nuts. You're a kick in the gut. Happy Christmas, my arse. I'll be glad it's our last.
Why? Hey. Why? Why did it need that much rewriting?
It did not need you're a squirrel because you're nuts.
What the fuck is that? So bad.
I mean, that replaced you scumbag, you maggot.
Yeah, why did that need replacing?
I have no idea. But yes, take the time to listen to it. It will be and it's 30 seconds longer. He slowed down the song.
All right. I am going to do it.
Thank you, John Bon Jovi. You ruined Christmas.
Your love is like bad medicine. That's a guilty pleasure song of Ben's, by the way.
How did he? Oh my God, you nailed it. How did he resist not throwing those lines? It's like you're trying to replace the lines. You're a bum, you're a punk. Your love is like bad medicine.
He's like, call back, get paid.
Uh-huh. That's better. Mm-hmm.
Bon Jovi out.
Oh man. All right. This is a good time because I want to do it before I forget to insert our 6 degrees of Tommy Stinson with Jeremy Essig. I listened to it earlier. It's really fucking funny.
Happy holidays, barflies. It's our last 6 degrees of Tommy Stinson for 2020. And this week, we're going to try to connect Stinson to the Pogues, or more specifically, their song, Fairytale of New York. The song is especially important because we begin the connection with Christy McCall, who duets on the song with Shane McGowan. McCall began her career a decade earlier with the song They Don't Know, which would eventually become a huge pop hit when covered by comedian Tracy Ullman 4 years later, eventually reaching the number two spot on the UK charts. Ullman would go on to create and star in The Tracy Ullman Show, which of course was the launching place for The Simpsons, a show that for 30 years has featured the voice work of Harry Shearer in roles such as Ned Flanders, Mr. Burns, and Dr. Hibbert, to name just a few. However, before his turn on The Simpsons, Shearer, taking on the character of bassist Derek Smalls, co-created the fictional band Spinal Tap with Christopher Guest and Michael McKean. Spinal Tap would reform for their reunion album, Break Like the Wind, in 1992, an album that would feature guest guitar work from Slash, who was in Guns N' Roses, as would later on be Tommy Stinson. So this week we traversed pub rock, comedians turn as a pop star, America's favorite family, the greatest metal band that never was, and finally the most dangerous band of the late 80s that it turns out included a guy named Saul and another with the middle name of Eugene. Have a great new year, y'all. Back to Diane and Ben.
And we're back. That was really great. Thank you, Jeremy, as always.
Was not expecting Jesus to appear, but all right.
All right. Do we have more on this? I don't want to wrap it up unless you have more, because... you did a lot of research, and I want you to say everything that you found.
Oh, wow. All right. Well, I mentioned it was 2 years old. Originally, the song was going to be about a captain in Western Ireland reminiscing or dreaming of moving to New York.
Yeah, I saw that.
And one of the songwriters, Jim, J-E-M Finer, I think his wife said, that's stupid. And so he said, give me an idea, and voila.
Always ask your wife.
Yeah, but seeing how the songs turned out, I could see the wife going, well, that's stupid. Okay, well, give me an idea. Okay, you're a loser and you're strangling my dreams. with your shitty
Actually,
fucking
maybe at
songwriting.
That point, maybe at that point, she looked at him and said, you're a bum, you're a punk.
Yeah.
Everything just flowed.
Yeah. Also,
apparently
like
at one point.
Go ahead.
one of the lyrics was, or one of the stanzas was, and Ben, as a poet, writer, you're going to hate this. It was a wild Christmas Eve on the west coast of Clare. I looked across the ocean, asked what's over there.
I do hate it.
Yeah. Yeah.
I call bullshit to that story. Having now read the lyrics and what was done, I refuse to believe that was ever put on paper and someone said, that's good enough.
That's good enough. No.
No, that Irish poetry is bad enough to make me want to set the Atlantic Ocean on fire. You guys stay over there. Stay over there. Sincerely. Sincerely, the president. All right, I'm sorry. I'm sorry, everybody.
I also like that Christy McCall was not supposed to be the singer of this song. Mm-mm. They had her just do it for, I can't remember the word they used, but just for the notes or whatever. And then they're like, no, she sounds great. Let her sing it.
Yeah, I think Shane even changed the way he sings his to fit her in the way that she did it, because she was all brassy and she was still forceful and had attitude, if you will. If you listen to the song, you know, the part about it was, I could have been someone, well, so could anyone. Like, that's the only part where she sings where there's sort of a female chorus behind her.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
You know, part of me thinks, like, I don't know, I read too much into it. Everything, but that was intentional, because that was perhaps a common empowerment thing. I don't know.
Like, every woman in the world is like, yeah.
Exactly. But I like the implication that line, because it kind of says, it's all lucky. You're going to get lucky or you're not.
Yeah.
You know, don't make yourself into more than you are. You know, shut up.
I like it. So you said you're not, like, when you were the one who were like, you have to do this song. And then I was like, oh my God, you're right. And we have to do it Christmas week. But you're just a fan of this song, but not the Pogues in general.
No. I come from the same music background as Odo. Like, I tried growing up to get into music, you know, but for the longest time, you know, I know you, Diane. I know you, Ben. Ben, I text you sometimes 3 days after you release something. Like, in my mind, I'm gonna send you a text message on something, and now you're gonna suddenly say it in the podcast I'm listening to. I'm not bright. And, you know, I was going through a list of Christmas songs. I was like, oh yeah, the Pogues. And I listened to it and I said, oh fuck, that's a great song and the lyrics are great. That's perfect for you guys. That's when I texted Ben and said, you're an idiot if you don't do this song.
Yeah.
And Ben wrote back, I don't know that song at all.
Oh. I sent it to him. But I know it now.
The drunken Christmas drinking song.
Well, what's crazy is my very Irish father-in-law, who loves Flogging Molly, he loves everything Irish, after we had decided the song was going in, like, sent me an email, like, I don't know if you've ever heard this song, but I think you guys should cover it. And it's Fairytale of New York. I'm like, how have you never heard this song? He's like, I just heard it for the first time. And he's 70.
The BBC doesn't play in Ireland.
I guess.
It makes sense, because
Go ahead.
I've just always dropped the Pogues in my brain have always fit in very neatly next to the Dropkick Murphys in the trash bin of my musical history. We're just like, I go over there, guys. Like, that's not the right place for the Pogues. And I feel bad for putting them there, but.
Yeah, I mean, the Pogues were a band that I wanted to like. Like, I had a list of bands that I wished I could find a way to like.
Yeah.
I wanted to like the Pogues. I wanted to like U2, sorry, Ben. I wanted to like a lot of bands, and I just couldn't. You know, other than like the Pixies and some weird stuff like the Judies and punk rock music, I really couldn't get into it. And the poetry is too traditional, too Irish for me to kind of give a shit. And I listened to Rum Sodomy and The Lash or whatever to get ready for this. And like three songs in, I was like, oh, no, I can't.
They just hit me. They, you know, it's some of their more famous songs, like I Love You Till the End. Like, I had friends who got married to that song. Like, there's some beautiful stuff in there. And also just the life of Shane McGowan, when you just watch the way he's looked and changed over the years. They're just fascinating to me.
Yeah. His whole background, I thought, was interesting. I mean, and it's you can see it in the song. He grew up in Ireland, his first 6 years in on a farm, no electricity, nothing like that, small town. His mother was a singer. He would go with her to pubs and she would sing and he would kind of join in. And then they moved to London. And he went to this upper end elite public school. He had a scholarship in literature, which I can't imagine what you have to do to get into a high school with a scholarship in literature.
Jeez.
But, you know, being the Irish kid in London in the 60s, 70s, from what I understand, the English didn't like the Irish very much.
I've heard something so about that.
All yeah. He was
beaten up and all that. And eventually was kicked out for doing Valium.
It's my new favorite drug, by the way.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, you can see the literature in the way he writes and everything else.
Oh, he's incredible.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Did you see that? Did you read the story about how he was kicked out of the band?
I just know that. I just know that he was. I just assumed it was for like being so fucked up all the time.
Mm-hmm. He was so unreliable. They were doing a tour in Japan. He was totally fucked up on sake. And you know, they got off a train and they said that they had two vans waiting for them. They put Shane in his own van. They said, "You're so fucked up, just go in that van." And the funny mental image in my mind is that, you know, he was just being brash and drunk and the way we all get when we're super drunk. And the Japanese were his hosts were trying to be as polite as they possibly could to this wild drunken Irishman and open the door and everything else. And he was just shoving things around and everything else. They got the van someplace and the guy went to open the door and Shane just fell out into the street. And I guess landed bad and got all bloodied and everything else. And they took him to the hospital and the band said, "You're out.
We can't do this anymore." Yeah.
You know, the guy who writes all the songs, our creative driving force, hit the bricks, buddy.
Mm-hmm. Instead, we're going to get Joe Strummer.
And Joe Strummer will just come right on in. Uh-huh. Yeah, but they said the idea is that he's been drunk continuously since he was 14 years old. I mean, his dad started letting him drink in pubs when he was really young and he just went for it his whole life.
Any one of those kids you saw, Diane, could be the next Shane.
Oh, no. One of those is Charlie's little girlfriend.
His little girlfriend could be the next Shane McGowan.
We expect big songwriting things from that couple, Diane. You make that happen.
I'll try. All right. Our misheard song lyric this week comes from Joan Clancy. Okay, do you remember when you had Krista Monster on the show, your friend, Ben?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And her our misheard song lyric was NXS's Suicide Blonde, and she heard Supersize a Blonde. And what's funny is on the Facebook message is my friend Joan popped in and said, "I heard Soup and Salad Bar." Krista said, "Maybe that's how she got supersized." So, Soup and Salad Bar. I just love the confusion of those lyrics.
It could be both. Supersized blonde switching to Super Salad Blonde.
Soup and Salad Bar. Robin. I already know that you have not one, but many guilty pleasure songs. Let's hear it.
Well, Ben already referenced one. I will admit, Baby It's Cold Outside is just it's a fun song for any baritone or bass singer to sing.
Right.
Yeah.
Rapey stuff aside. It's not a phrase I use very often in my life. but I was thinking about it and two songs came to mind. And I don't know if either of these have come up. There's that song by Berlin, Sex, I'm A.
Is that, how's it singing?
I'm a blue movie, I'm a. All right.
Is that where she's like, "I'm a slut, I'm a,"
yes.
Whatever. Okay, yeah.
Yeah, that's one of those ones where if I'm drunk and it's playing on the jukebox, I will scream that one.
I'm a man.
I'm a
bitch.
I'm a man.
I'm a B-shot.
I'm a man.
Sarah Talamash said like a lot of strippers used to strip to that. I just spit. You can't see that on TV. That a lot of strippers would strip to that song. She just thinks of that song in that way.
I still can't wrap my mind around Sarah's past.
I don't think she can either. All right, what's another one?
The You Spin Me Right Round by Dead or Alive.
Dead or Alive. Rest in peace, Peter.
Yeah. And while we're on topic, also Christy McCall.
Oh. Oh, I thought you were going to do another song by her because I saw she was made famous by a song that was covered. Shit. Now I can't remember my research because I didn't write it down. You're going to have, okay, everybody Google Christy McCall, like what she was famous for. It was like her first hit was then covered by someone else and then put in like a TV show or a commercial.
You don't fail me.
Oh, are you looking it up now?
Uh-huh.
Peter
Burns. I can't make this work on a podcast.
I'll just cut that out. Or I'll just leave it for the listeners and torture them with it.
Mm-hmm.
All right, Robin, that was awesome. That was really, really good. This was a good episode. Thank you so much for having us do this song. I'm really happy. You don't do comedy anymore. Is there anything you would like to promote?
Do you have a lot of money, want to sue someone, and are willing to give large sums of money to someone based on what you heard in the podcast? Well, then I'm your guy. So no, I have nothing to
do. What kind of law do you put before, like I may need you one day, what kind of law do you do?
Commercial litigation and real estate, largely landlord-tenant, but also breach of contract, business formation.
Okay.
We just lost all of our listeners.
Okay. I don't know. I'm making a mental list. You never know when you're going to need somebody. Thank you.
Absolutely.
Robin, thank you so much for being on the show. This was great.
This was fun.
Lovely talking to you, sir.
Good to see you all.
All right.
Best to Sabrina.
Yes.
I will.
I'm going to kick you out now. Bye, Robin.
Okay. 1, 2, 3.
Rock the Cash Bar is produced by Diane Gallagher. Music by Chuck Savage and Eddie Hawkins. Special thank you to Jeremy Essig for 6 Degrees and to Sarah Wessling for the Guilty Pleasures vocals. Our website is rockthecashbarpodcast.com, and there you can find links to our Spotify playlist and to our Patreon. Thank you for tuning in, and we will see you next week.